Hey there, Tim Berglund here at the end of the summit, and I want to thank you for being with us. And I hope if you're here live, I hope you've been able to participate in the platform and interact with folks, speakers through Q&A and meet with each other online and do all those great things. Hopefully next year we'll be back together in person, and we can maybe do some of those online things in addition to actually shaking hands and seeing each other in the flesh. But you know, having said all that, I just kind of want to look back on some of the content today. I've got some ideas that to me tie things together, and I want to see maybe if they do the same for you. Now, there's this language that folks are starting to use to describe the work we're doing, this emerging phrase, data in motion. I think a lot of the time we talk about like event-driven architecture as the broad category of work that we do. But this is kind of a catchy phrase that people are using to describe, you know, what it is Kafka is and the event-driven systems we build around it. It's really data that's moving around, not data that's sitting somewhere. Not that there's anything wrong with that. Databases are good things, but it's data that's in motion. That's kind of the thing. And that got me thinking about physical analogies. Now, if you saw my talk earlier, see it later, whatever, I spend a while on this. And I kind of want to summarize some of these ideas because to me, they're compelling. And I guess I'm kind of testing them out on you too. I want to see if they're compelling to you too. But I kind of like these, this idea of thinking about streaming in terms of properties, kind of primitive properties of the physical universe, even constraints that we have. Let's start with time. Now, in a distributed system, every node in the system has a different clock, and those clocks are not synchronized. Now, we have systems like NTP to keep everybody basically lined up, you know, but that's actually plus or minus 10 milliseconds is the nominal error bar on an NTP synchronized, a fleet of servers that are synchronized with NTP. To actually have things be the same time involves special cabling and special circuitry, and there's this whole kind of a circuit called a phase-locked loop. That's this thing that electrical engineers have developed to create a defined relationship between a clock here and a clock there. And we don't do that. Like, nobody does that in data centers. It's not. I've looked. Right. It's not a thing. So we tend to worry a lot less about when, like what time it actually is, and we try to reduce the problem to one of sequence. In what order did things happen? Because that's usually what you care about. You know, you want to make your flight. I don't care. And actually, as I record this tomorrow morning, I am, believe it or not, getting on an airplane. It is possible to do that in a safe way at 7:50 in the morning. I don't care that it's 7:50 in the morning. I just care that I'm there before they close the gate. So sequence is usually what matters. And that's why you want to know time. And so we struggle with sequence. Time, fundamentally unknowable. You don't know when. You just want to know in what order. So that's one thing. All right. When things are physically separate in space, two things happen. One is that it takes time for signals to propagate between them. And two is that we have to build networks. Now, briefly, we usually blame the speed of light as a limiting factor in the design of distributed systems or networks. And it's a thing. You don't get to break that rule. It's not just a good idea. It's the law. But as I said in my talk, a laser beam from here to London is about 2.5 milliseconds. That's Denver, where I am right now. It's about 4,700 miles, 2.5 milliseconds to get there. Ping, for me to ping an IP from where I am in London, it's about 120, 130 on a bad day, milliseconds. So there's the conductors, and it takes work, because even like a trace on a circuit board or a wire in a microprocessor, microscopic wire, they're not pure superconductors, and they're not even just resistors. They're resistors and capacitors and inductors all in one, and it just takes all this work to push signals through them, really. And that's true of long conductors and short ones. They always have those parasitic components to them. And then we also have to build networks because you don't have a point-to-point connection to everything. That's too expensive. There are all these power laws in the way things connect to each other, power law probability distributions. So we build networks. And networks are complex things with unpredictable latency. So, if I have really a circuit between me and something in London, truly a long wire, that would be impractical, but work with me, then I'd know what the latency was. It would be 2.5 milliseconds. But in fact, I have maybe 10 or 15 individual routers. And if we could really simplify things and say, there are only 10 or 15 point-to-point connections between those routers, logically there are. Well, because of all those connections, I still have lots of delay that can happen. And it's unpredictable. It's slow and it's unpredictable. Just like flying, right? If I walk to my car, that's quick. If I drive to the airport, I don't quite know how long it's going to take. There could be traffic. Flight could be delayed at the airport. So that's super unpredictable. So small distances, simple links, predictable. Space in general, hard to work with and delay in the way we build networks. So if when is a problem, what is even worse? And I've heard informal definitions of distributed systems as systems that negotiate the emerging state of a system. And also there's the fun little aphorism that state has weight. And it really works to think of bits as if they have physical mass. They don't. They're information, and information is maybe troubling, but it's fundamentally a non-material thing. But state has weight is a faithful maxim. So we've got time, space, mass. I want to look at the keynotes that we've had here at Kafka Summit. So let's just remind ourselves of something that Jay said. And by the way, I'm ruthlessly stealing some slides from my fellow keynoters just for illustration purposes here. Jay talked about data in motion, all right? And there's this platform that's kind of Kafka and all the components around it and some stuff that Confluent has done. We like to talk about that as being a big part of it. And as that platform has become standardized, that's storage and integration through Kafka Connect and compute through Kafka Streams and KSQL DB and all those kinds of things. As each part of that becomes standardized, people move up the stack. My favorite thing that Grady Booch has ever said is that the history of software engineering is one of increasing layers of abstraction. And in Jay's keynote, he hit on that very, very point. And so the march to the cloud, which is resulting, we get this kind of platform, these software components, and suddenly now all this stuff wants to go to the cloud, is because operating these things is difficult. And he made that point, I think, elegantly and from his own hard-won experience. But the real physical constraints underlying these systems have to do with time and mass. Okay, these are event-driven systems. There's an order in which events happen. So we need to understand time and manage time. And events have state. And so that means that there is state that we have to move around from the external system into the topic, into the compute layer. There's time and mass to contend with. And so those are, I think, the fundamental physical constraints that come to the fore when we look just at event streaming at a high level. Jean-Marc talked about data mesh. Now, data mesh solves a space problem. Data is, at least as I see it, and again, this is a new idea. I'm kind of testing this on you. Tell me what you think in the comments or on Twitter. Data is in one place, the operational system. And she did a great job, I think fairly critiquing the traditional practice of taking data from the operational system and moving it to the analytic system in this traditional way that we've thought. Now, they're separate systems for valid reasons. And the moving of that data across space wasn't just a matter, like the problems to solve there, wasn't just a matter of getting the parasitic reactances figured out, there's the capacitance here, I have to charge up, and it's hard to move electricity through this conductor. It's not that. It's that, if I could change space analogies here, one ship's airlocks aren't compatible with the other ship's airlocks. And so ETL had to happen to get them to connect. And she told us that story, I think very elegantly. And so data mesh's answer is not to make smarter airlocks. That's what ETL and big data vendors have been doing since, like, literally before I started writing software professionally. The answer is to do what to analytics, what microservices did to software, to bundle data sources as self-contained products running on common infrastructure. So there's a fundamental space problem here of where I do stuff to data and where I ask questions about data, those are different places. And I'm gonna let that be assumed. I think I could make that argument, but let us assume that an analytics system and an operational system, that they're not the same. But the way we've been getting data, moving data through space, has been naive. And we've thought, well, it's just a matter of getting the pipes right. If we just had airlocks, that would, right, you know, everything would be fine. She proposed, I think, what was a much more elegant solution of really trying to productize individual data sources, to do to data and analytics what microservices have done to applications. So very much worth thinking about. And I think worth thinking about in terms of it being a solution to this problem with space. And Jay spoke to Felix Bohm about using Kafka and Confluent Cloud for factory automation at BMW. Now, Felix is responsible for a factory, this giant and very cool Internet of Things application. In IoT, I think you see time and mass again, because a factory is fundamentally an event-driven system. You need to know what happened, that is the bits of the state, the mass, and you need to know in what order, that's the time at which they happened, in order to make good decisions about what to do next and how to operate the plant in real time. So I think it's really time and mass that show up there. So I'm not saying that these things are absolute or they make the march to the cloud some kind of necessity that derives inexorably from the laws of physics or anything like that. But I think they're pretty faithful perspectives. I think they work in an interesting way. I got thinking about this after a conversation with my friend Pat Helland about his paper called The Space-Time Discontinuum. I should have read it before that already, but unfortunately he had to tell me and then I read it. You know, I should keep up on Pat's reading a little bit more, and I think we all should. But that kind of got me thinking about these physical analogies. And I think, you know, they sort of make sense. It's like, well, certainly time is a problem. Space is a problem. It's like we are moving mass around. And the properties of those things in the physical world seem to mirror the way they behave in the systems that we build. Now, why the cloud? So if you look at the history of science, why the cloud? We talk a lot about cloud at Kafka Summit these days. If you look at the history of science, science starts out, at least if I could constrain it to the Western tradition, being commingled with philosophy. You've got, say, the pre-Socratic philosophers in, 500 BC and earlier. They're thinking about earth, air, fire, water, quintessence, what is reality fundamentally. They're kind of doing science, but in a not very empirical way. It doesn't look like science to us. Then we start to figure out little bits of physics and chemistry and astronomy and biology, and they kind of chisel off of just thinking about the world and become their own disciplines. Now, philosophy still matters. We still have to have a way of thinking about thinking. Doesn't go away. But what are we doing there? We're moving up the stack. We start to get questions answered, and we become more specific in the things that we can do. So at CERN, for example, when they're doing things with particle accelerators, they don't think about the theory of knowledge or what makes the good life. At least they don't think about those things professionally. And likewise, as we establish these little bits of streaming physics that you've seen here, the platform grows and develops. I talked about this last year at Kafka Summit, last August in 2020, about the development of the community and these stages that people go through and the stages that Kafka is going through. And, we see Connect entering the world 6 years ago, now, 7 years ago now, and then Streams 5 years ago, and ksqlDB as another contribution, and fully managed Kafka with, platform components in them. All these things happen. And I really think that those fully managed cloud services are kind of the apotheosis of that process. And we look at the way our understanding of the physical universe has proceeded, and just in that little microcosm in the 11 or 12 years of Kafka being a thing, it has kind of followed that same path, which makes me think cloud native data systems are, as has been said here, almost necessarily the future. So again, thank you so much for being here at Kafka Summit. I hope you have benefited tremendously from the content and the interaction, not just in the keynotes, but in all the sessions. And I know there were too many to watch all today, but they're still available to you as recordings. I encourage you to go through the catalog, learn everything you can, keep contributing to this amazing community. Thank you.